gets included. Yeah.
Thank you for
that.
Any? Can you give me one gram?
Thank you. So I have got a Sebura Guru from
Thank you. Thank you. you're restricting any movement to the upper level, or the works going on during the week. So we're restricting anyone from going upstairs. We're asking to find a seat downstairs in one of the pews. Thank you very much.
Was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and of hell. Because I live, you shall live also. And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain. For the first things are passed away. I welcome you to this service of thanksgiving and remembrance for one who was close and dear to all of us. And I invite you now to share in one of the glorious hymns of the Christian faith. Through all the changing scenes of life, in trouble and in joy, the praises of my God shall still my heart and tongue employ. Pray be seated. My dear brothers and sisters and friends, we are met in another solemn moment, this time to commend the eternal soul of Michele Antrobus into the hands of the Almighty God, our Heavenly Father. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer. And it is in the name of Jesus Christ, and in that name alone, that we have salvation. Let us then, for a moment, recall to mind the life of our dear departed daughter, sister, mother, friend, neighbor, as we invite our brother, Pastor the Reverend Martin Labord, to do the eulogy.
Minister Maul, Pastor Jack, and any other ministers of the gospel, my dear wife, and members of the immediate family and extended family, friends all. The eulogy of Michele Antrobus. Today, I stand to make a few remarks on behalf of my cousin Michele Antrobus. I knew her for all of her life, as I am her senior by 10 years. She is the fourth child of Conrad and Eileen Antrobus, née Joseph Labord. That is for Eileen. On her father's side of the family, she has several brothers and sisters, including Itano, Lewis, and Calvert, all of the USA. On her mother's side, she has a brother, Leslie, and sister, Zena. Michele grew up in Redemption Shops in the late 60s to mid 80s, when things were not as bad as they are today. She grew up in a somewhat privileged life, as her parents owned what we will consider to be substantive businesses in those days. Her parents owned one of the largest bakeries in St. Vincent, a restaurant and a supermarket in Kingstown, and acres of land in Villa Fountain. These properties were all owned by Con and his wife Eileen. I remember Michele and her biological sister, Anne, getting a car, a Daihatsu Charmant P25, while still a teenage. She was never short of good care, and I think she was somewhat spoiled by her father, since she was the only female child of his marriage. Her father was very proud of her. I had the privilege of being around the family a lot for various reasons. Most importantly, survival. My younger brothers and I depended on the return bread to the bakery to get by. My mother and I helped in working the lands at Villa Fountain, tending pigs and weeding ginger. I believe Con started a revolution in pig farming in this country, as I had never seen anyone with a larger pig farm at the time. When I finished St. Martin's School in 1975, I assisted my aunt in their grocery shop in Sharps to get a little money to get by. Later on, from January 1976, Conn employed me in his bakery to run the office, but later fired me on June the 2nd for not carrying out his instructions. When I started at the marketing corporation, and I'm proud to say that the minister and I worked there together, he was senior to me. When I started at the marketing corporation in October 1976, I traveled with Michelle and her brothers in her Uncle David Antrobus' car for lunch at her parents' home, whether it was Halbish House in Villa or up Warners Hill or even in Arnesville in a building now occupied by General Hardware. Michelle had a light head, as we will say, in the older days, meaning she learned things very easily. Her primary education was at the Kingstown Preparatory School, her secondary education at the Girls' High School, and then she went overseas to further her education. On her return to St. Vincent, she became engrossed in supporting her mother's business activities, a grocery shop in Sharps, and later Tiss's agribusiness, which was involved in producing green seasoning, pepper sauce, and bottled peanuts. She took over that business fully on the passing of her mother, including setting up her own small bakery. She also assisted her brothers in the supermarket they had set up in Sharps. Michelle was always looking to do something to live and survive. Much focus, very industrious, always trying to get by and move ahead. I am told she was driven by the words of a very popular song by Bojo Banton, "It is not an easy road." Michelle was a very private person who didn't seek recognition or attention. She was a woman of fortitude and grit, determined and devout. She was genial in her disposition, but took nonsense from no one. She was as plain as a book and will tell you off in a second without thinking. Admittedly, she had an "I am always right" attitude. She depended on no one, always trying to get something to go by in life. She spoke and walked briskly with an air of confidence, steadfast and focused. She was generous in her giving, always willing to stretch her hand out to someone in need. Michelle mothered three children, daughters, Kishana, Kajiso, whom I'm more familiar with, and Khadija. She loved these children and did her best to support them. She was also the grandmother of two grandsons, Kumari and Kaijen. Life is always filled with challenges, and sometimes we think life is unfair, but it never is unfair. What we need to do is to make the best of whatever life hands us. Make orange juice with orange, and lime juice with limes. It is when we try to make orange juice with lime, because we like orange juice, that we feel that life is unfair. Michelle battled one of the world's most terrible diseases for many years, until the very end. During our interactions, I never saw her cry, nor hear her complain. She never thought that life was unfair. She battled and fought and stood up to life's challenges as a good soldier. My fervent hope is that she had time to make reconciliation with her fellow men and her God. I wish to take this opportunity to challenge all of us here today. Whatever your status in life, whatever your belief, whatever your religion, make yourself ready for life after death, because there is a judgment day coming for all men, with no excuses will be accepted. May she rest in peace.
And after that brief yet comprehensive recollection and remembrance of our sister, mother, grandmother, daughter, friend, neighbor, we stand now before the other tributes and pray to God. Let us stand as we pray. Please stand. And I invite you to recall to mind some of what you've just heard concerning our sister, the one for whom we grieve at this time. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we turn to you in the sorrow and grief of our bereavement, praying that we may find the strength we need in your sustaining grace, so that even as we mourn the death of Michele, whom we knew and loved, we may not be overcome by this trial, but may hold fast, trusting in your goodness and your mercy. Assure us, O Lord our God, and especially her daughters and grandchildren, that this is not the end for her, neither will it be the end for those who put their trust in you. And so, Father God, may our hearts be so composed in the Holy Spirit that all fear and doubt and disappointment may be swallowed up in the light and peace you give to your troubled children. Almighty and eternal God, by the Holy Spirit, you minister to us in our weakness. And by the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us the pledge of eternal life. Lift us now, we pray, above our present disappointment and sorrow, and shed the light of your grace and your glory upon us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And what a wonderful moment it is for us simply to turn to those around us, and especially you the dear family of my sister, her daughters. It's a good time to turn to each other and say, God bless you. Or say to your sister, say to your friend, I love you, I love you, I love you, God bless you. Yes, 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 yes. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. And now let us sit as we hear two further tributes. One from Raquel or Rachel Richards, and the other from Khadijah and Joseph Antrobus. Would you come now in that order?
Thank you. to watch for us, anxious if we will live it, in winter by the window, in summer by the gate. And though we mocked her tenderly, we had such foolish care. The long way home would seem more safe because she waited there. Her thoughts were also full of us, she never could forget. And so I think that where she is, she must be watching yet. Wait until we come home to her, anxious if we are late. Watching from heaven's window, leaning from heaven's gate.
Thank you so much. And now we prepare to hear the messages from Holy Scripture chosen by the relatives and friends for today. The first reading will come from Psalm 130, read by Suzanne Goodlock, followed by a reading from Romans chapter 8, and then by the Gospel.
Good afternoon, church. A reading from Psalm 130, reading verses 1 through 8. From the depths of despair, O Lord, I call for your help. Hear my cry, O Lord. Pay attention to my prayer. Lord, if you keep a record of our sins, who, O Lord, who could ever survive? But you offer forgiveness, that we might learn to fear you. I am counting on the Lord. Yes, I am counting on him. I put my hope in his word. I long for the Lord more than centuries long for the dawn. Yes, more than centuries long for the dawn. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is unfailing love. His redemption overflows. He himself will redeem Israel from every kind of sin. This is the word of the Lord.
Romans 8:31-39. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his own son, but gave up for us all. How will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, neither angels, nor demons, neither the present, nor the future, nor any powers, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
I invite you to stand for the reading of the Gospel. The Gospel is according to John, the 11th chapter, verses 17 through 27. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the grave 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away. And many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." "Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." This, my dear brothers and sisters, is the Gospel of Christ. Praise be to Christ, our Lord. Let us join in another hymn. "Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father."
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow turning with thee. Thou takest up thy compassion, it is not. As thou hast been, thou forever.
Of the hearts of all of us, be heard and understood in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. And so, my dear brothers and sisters, as I join in expressing sympathy to the family of our deceased sister, and especially to those closest and dearest to her, I commend to us all words from Paul, the Prince of the Apostles, in his second letter to the Corinthians. The first chapter, verses 3 and 4. Blessed be God, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulations. Blessed be God, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulations. And I prepared these words especially with you three young ladies and your families in mind. And I pray that God will enable you to hear the message. The reality of death and suffering is not unique. It is universal. No one can escape it. It was Job Job, that giant of faith in the Old Testament, who said, man is born to trouble as the sparks fly upward. Man is born to trouble as the sparks fly upward. Most of the older persons and you in here, if not all of us, have heard and know very well the story of Job. Job experienced severe difficulties. He was a godly man, a good man, but he was seriously afflicted with a multitude of problems. He was wealthy. Yes, he was rich, but he lost all his wealth. He had a family of beautiful children, but he lost all of them, one and all. He was strong and robust, but he lost his health. He had a wife and many good friends, but he lost their sympathy. They stopped sympathizing with him because they thought, look, he's a madman. He's a dotish man. He's a stupid man to be trusting in God, who apparently doesn't care anything about him. And so he became heartbroken. So he asked himself, where could I go? Where could I go? To whom could I flee for comfort? Who could heal my broken heart? Who could satisfy my soul and bring peace to my troubled heart? These were the questions that he posed all the time in his dilemma. But he concluded at the end of it all that there was only one person, one person to whom he could go, and that one person was God. God, God, and God alone. And so, turning away from human sympathy and advice and human help, he echoed the cry that mankind has continued to echo throughout the ages, and the cry that some of us echo today. But God, if you are so real, and if you are so good, where are you? Where are you in all of this? Where could I find you? I know that you are there. I know that you are real, but I can't seem to be able to find you. I know that you care. I know that you have all the answers to everything that troubles me today. But I can't find you. I can't find you. Where are you? Jesus himself prayed on the night before he died in all his agony, as he lifted up himself in prayer to God, he says, "Oh my God, oh my God, if it were possible, don't make me have to go through this. If it is possible, Lord God, I don't want to have to go through this. It is so much pain, so much discomfort. Don't make me have to go through this if it is possible." But, you remember the but? "Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." Not my will, but your will be done. Even on the cross again, even on the cross, he echoed, he said, "My God, why have you forsaken me?" Because that's how it felt. That is how it felt to him, to Jesus. Why have you forsaken me? Good. Maybe as some theologians have asked, it wasn't "why have you forsaken me," but rather have you forsaken me? Have you? It's a difference. Brother Martin, not why you have forsaken me, but have you forsaken me? And hear the end of it. After they had done all to him, after he had suffered all, yes, after they had abused him, and he went through all that he went through, hear the end of it. He said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Yes, Father, you are right all the time. Yes, Father, your will is the best for us all the time. And now I have come to the end. I commend my soul, my spirit, into your hands. Yes. 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 Today, many of us are confronted with the same problem that confronted Job many years ago. Why? Why, if God is good, why, if God loves us, why do we have to suffer? Why do our loved ones have to be taken from us, sometimes so suddenly that they don't even have time to say a proper goodbye? Why? Why, if God be Father, is the world so full of pain? Why? Yes, my dear friends and my dear young ladies, these are the vital questions which every human heart asks from time to time. And frankly, despite the numerous volumes that have been written concerning these questions, despite the many powerful sermons that have been preached by some of the most gifted and well-meaning and sincere preachers, there is only one. There is only one person to whom we could go for the answers. The answers to these questions, my friends. And that one is God. God, 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 and God again. The one of whom Paul speaks when he says, "Blessed be God." You hear him? You hear him today? Paul, who had his own difficulties and problems too, beginning with his unbelief in Jesus. Paul, who like the disciples before him, came to know Jesus. Yes, he said, "Blessed be the God of all comfort, the God of Jesus Christ, the God whom your mother always told you about, the God whom she loved and worshipped. I prayed with her a day or two before she left, through the auspices of our friend Suzanne and my wife. Prayed with her in a car in town of another friend. Went. Yes, and we thought that all will be well. Yes. She believed in God. She trusted God. And I have no reason to believe that this is how she died. I heard you read and I heard you recite, my dear young ones here today. And I know and I felt that God is with you. I see that you're not broken down and mashed up by it, but that somehow you feel strong. Yes, you feel strong today. And I put it to you that you're strong today because you recognize your mother's faith in God. Of faith in God, and you know that death for her has not been the end. And this is the message that we have for you today. Put your faith, your trust in God, the God of all comfort, because His will is the best. That's why Jesus taught us to pray when we pray, what? Our Father, who art in heaven, thy will be done. You hear it? Thy will be done. Not my will, not yours, not any politician, not anybody else, but thy will, God's will, be done on earth as it is in heaven. And in that regard, everything with God in it works together for the good of all of it. And so long as you live, you'll remember your mother. For as long as you live, you will feel her presence near to you. For as long as you live, you will hear her speaking to you. For as long as you live, you will feel her direction. You remember the things she told you as to how you are to grow up and how you are to behave. And you will turn to God and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God, for my mother. Thank you for what she has taught me. I am getting old now, and there's not a day in my life when I don't remember the things that my mother taught me. Bless her, and all of us here today, I'm sure, if we had a good mother, would remember that. And those of us who still have mothers, we better start to pay attention, if they're good mothers, to the things they teach us, especially about our faith and our trust in God. It was King David, the psalmist, and you know the psalm very well, 23, but in Psalm 61, he says, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me. Let me hear you, lead me. Higher. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Who's the rock? God in Jesus Christ. When my heart is overwhelmed, as is happening to you now, when my heart is overwhelmed, when I feel I can't take it anymore, when I feel that there is no hope, when I don't understand all that's happening in the world, when I look at all the injustice, when I feel all the pain, all the unfairness, when people try to pull me down and mash me up, yes! When the challenges and the difficulties come, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Yes. And you're familiar with the psalm. You're familiar with the 23rd psalm, the most popular psalm in the world today. The words which says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. This is the God to whom we commend you today. The family and all of us who may be grieving, and all of us who may have doubts. Doubts as you look at what is happening in the world around you. Aye, in every sphere, in every direction, my God, even in the churches. Yes, yes, we commend you to God. He's a God who loves. He's a God who cares. He's a God who understands. He's a God who never fails. He did not fail Job. He did not fail Jesus. He did not fail Paul. That's why Paul to point you to the God of all comfort. He did not fail those who have left this world before us, especially those who are related to us. He did not fail them. He did not fail our fathers and our mothers. He did not fail Michele. He did not fail Michele. And he will not fail you. You understand? He will not fail you. We commend you to this God. And may he continue to walk with you and inspire you and protect you as he sees necessary, and to lift you up and your offspring. Yes, some of them unborn, many of them still unborn. Your offspring, now and always. And the whole church is going to say three times as they point their finger in your direction. They're going to say three times, God bless you. Church, stand up. Family, sit down. Family, sit down. Church, stand up. Stand up, church. Immediate family, sit down. Immediate family, sit down. Children of our sister, sit down. Just raise your hand, point it to them, and three times on cue we say, God bless you. Again, God bless you. And again, God bless you. Amen and amen. And let us remain standing as we join in the Apostles' Creed. Yes, confirming what we have just heard. Together we say, I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And I believe in Jesus Christ. Ascended into heaven. On the third day he rose again from the dead. God is mighty. I believe in the Holy Spirit and the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection and the life of the last. Amen. Let us sit now before the final prayers. And we hear another tribute that has been inadvertently omitted. And so we invite that person to come with the other tribute now. Yes, and sometimes these things happen, and we just say these things happen for the better. Maybe this is the best place for this to come. Let us open up our hearts and let us hear it now. Hear it now.
Good afternoon, church. I just want to take this opportunity to convey my deepest and sincerest condolences to the family of the bereaved, and especially to Kajiso, who I'm most familiar with. And I trust that you will be comforted with the words of this song. This song did minister to me as I was preparing it. It's a new song I've never sang before. But it's such a wonderful song. It's coming straight from the scripture. And it reassures us that there is hope in Jesus. Amen. There is hope in Jesus.
Amen.
For the scripture teaches us that the Lord himself will one day descend with a shout, with the trump of God, with the voice of the archangel. He will descend. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain, we shall be caught up in the clouds to meet him in the air.
Praise the Lord.
One day we'll make everything new, Jesus. One day you will bind up the wounds. The former things shall all pass away. No more tears. One day you'll make sense of it all, Jesus. One day all the sorrow will pass, and every anxious thought left behind, no more fears. And when we all place. Is there a rain of Asia of grace? For in a moment we shall be changed. Oh, in a moment we shall be changed. In a moment we shall be changed. Oh, what a day of rejoicing that will be when we see Jesus. He's coming in His glory. We will sing and shout the victory. Give God some praise. Hallelujah.
Please remain standing. My favorite hymn is God Moves in a Mysterious Way His Wonders to Perform. And I have no doubt in my mind that it is the Spirit who ensured that this item came at the time that it did. Brother Bailey, excuse me, but the next hymn is It Is Well With My Soul. I'm sure you know that. And with Brother Bailey's permission, we're going to let the gentleman stay on the piano, and you will lead it as we sing It Is Well With My Soul.
Yeah.
Amen. 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 Let us remain standing now for the final prayers. Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you are still God. And we thank you today for all your love and your blessings, your mercy and your grace that followed our dear Michele over her life. And we thank you for the promise that you will be with her dear ones, especially her children and grandchildren, throughout their generations. Yes, Father God, and we thank you that now that for her the trials and tribulations of this world are over and death itself is past, you will receive her into your heavenly kingdom. And so today we pray for each other, especially those of us who have peculiar needs. And we pray for those close and dear to us everywhere, those who mourn with us today, and those who from time to time have their doubts. We pray for those who are weak and need your strength. We pray for those who have sinned that you have mercy on them. Yes, we pray for those who, like us, sorrow today and grieve today for the loss of loved ones. Yes, Father God, even as we grieve today and as we mourn, we pray for peace in your word. Keep us through. Keep us through to our God, who is the one true living God of this universe. And so, Lord God, in all ways we trust you and we commend ourselves to you, and we join with all the saints here on earth and the saints in heaven in offering you honor and praise and glory. And so, God, all that you have given us is yours. And at first you gave Michele to us. And now, O God, we give her back to you. Receive the soul of our sister, mother, daughter, friend, neighbor, grandmother, Michele, into the arms of your mercy. Raise her up with all your people above. Receive us also and raise us up to new life, even as we continue our sojourn here on earth. And so help us so to love and serve you in this world, that we may enter into the joy of the world to come. And I invite you to stretch your hand, whichever hand it is, forward now as we pray. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Michele. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive Michele into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints of life. Together, rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord. And we say, and let light perpetual shine upon her. Amen. Amen. We join now in our closing hymn. And can it be that I should gain an increase in the Savior's blood?
Thank you. name of Christ the Son, redeem you. The name of the Spirit makes you with us and tell them above that your heart is a God with all comfort. The God the Father bless you. The God the Son is here. And the God the Holy Spirit will accompany you now and always. Amen.
Thank you.
from the room.
Somewhere wrong here.
The cameraman?
Let me try anything.
Huh?
Try anything. Depends on the internet.
Service of the middle is a giant hymn printed in the order. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Neither death nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. We know that if this earthly house of our tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Since our sister Michele has departed out of this life, and Almighty God in His mercy has taken her to Himself, we therefore commit her body to the ground, dust to dust, ashes to ashes, earth to earth, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for He has visited and redeemed His people and has raised up a mighty salvation for us in the house of His servant David. Yes, my friends, I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, from now forward, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. Let us pray. O merciful God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all comfort, raise us up, we pray, from the death of sin to the new life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life,
we too shall be found acceptable in your sight. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant to the grieving family, O Father God, consolation and faith in this time of trial. Grant to them the blessed hope in the coming of your kingdom, the sustaining grace in the fellowship of your people, and steadfastness in the service of your name and the doing of your will through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord our God, support us all the day long of this challenging life until the shadows lengthen, the evening comes, and the busy world is hushed, and our work is done. And then, O Lord, in your mercy, grant unto us safe lodging, holy rest, and peace at last, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And together we say, the grace of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, now and always. Amen. Join in another hymn listed, Blessed Assurance, Jesus.
Thank you.
sleep
Same number.